this box is called the XPK. I don't want to make it sound too much of a sales pitch because I'm from Bosch. Why I made this talk is because apparently, you know, by accident, I'm kind of working in a Chinese company, and then we kind of talked about this, and he said, hey, why not talk about this? For sure, why not? But I would be remiss if I not talked about MEMS, yeah? Because this board is a sensor board, and it's got tons of MEMS sensors, and at Bosch, we are a big place of MEMS sensors, yeah? And I would like to talk a bit more about that. So, anybody heard of MEMS or not heard of MEMS? Yeah. So basically, sensors come in all sizes. We have small sensors to like hadron collider is a sensor as well, huge sensor. But MEMS, when you speak about MEMS, you're talking about really tiny sensors. What you call micro electromechanical systems. So they're really. I'll try. After chai latte. So these are sensors which are really, really small. Typically they are 2 microns in size, and they are basically tiny transducers. So they take a small output and change energy to another output. Yeah? Yes, buddy. That's a microphone? Where do you find sensors? So chances are, if you have a smartphone in your pocket, there's a sensor in there. So Bosch, 3 out of 4 smartphones uses a Bosch MEMS sensor. So chances are, your mobile phone really has a Bosch sensor. So 75% of the MEMS sensors are not located in consumer electronics, and they produce tons of sensors. Why we do this is because traditionally we are, yeah, probably the BBS as well, yeah. So Bosch is an automotive company, yeah, and in cars, obviously, you need to track how cars are, like what's the vibration, how they move, and things like that. Bosch has found it useful to actually invest in this technology, and we thought, like, hey, you know, instead of automotive, we can actually use it in the consumer market as well. Yeah, so that's why we dedicated quite a fair amount of our resources into MEMS sensors. Yeah. Look familiar? Yeah. So if you use any of these are all Bosch sensors. Yeah. So BNO 55 is a sensor fusion. So that's the trend these days when it comes to sensors, where you take multiple sensors. In this case, it's a gyroscope and an accelerometer and things like that. Put in together, put some algorithms like Kalman filters, and just give you the output itself. You don't have to do all this messy calculation. These are sensor fusion chips. BME is the environmental sensors, and pressure sensors. Yeah, these are the pressure sensors, and these are this guy who is the really old one. This BME with it 5. Oh. Yeah, and these are, by the way, Adafruit sensors.
Okay, yeah. So me.
Okay, I took this picture in the morning, just to show scale. Actually, do I sound fine? Can you guys hear at the back? Yeah. Okay. That's it. Okay. I'm not sure if there's any better. Yeah? Much better like this? Okay.
So, okay.
I took this photo in the morning. I brought the sensors, or rather the chip later you can see. But to scale, you can see how small they are. So this is 1.8 MV and 0.603. And this is the older BMP sensor and the new one. So you can see how really small they are. So, with that aside, the XDK. So Bosch came out with this white box called the XDK, which is like the all-in-one sensor kit. Why we did this is because we were going to the IoT industry, and then we needed ways of prototyping, finding out how to collect data from use cases. Yeah. So typically, you work with Arduino. You have these tons of wires. You have to provide power, tons of hats and such like that, or sheets. And this is really not easy to work with. So we came up with this box here. Yeah. So for this box, you do not need any assembly. It's got about 8 sensors in there, and it's pretty handy. It comes with a mounting board, and you can just mount it on something and use it. Yeah. And pretty important that it's CEFCC and IEC certified. Why is this important? It's because when you're going to a customer and you're deploying these things, for example, we have use cases where we put into a lift. If this thing catches fire, it's going to be a problem, right? So we need to make it certified. Yeah?
So like that?
Yeah, okay. So these are sensors inside. Pretty much everything except for the light sensor is a watch sensor. Yeah? Actually, let me go to the next page. So that's the spec of this sensor. Temperature meter, the acoustic noise sensor, and the electronic sensor. And if you notice, the frequency is pretty high. It's 2,000 values per second, 1,300, 1,006, 3,000. The reasons for this is because for some use cases, we need to collect a lot of data. And I will explain to you a bit why. It has three programmable LEDs for the push button. Microcontroller in there. Tons of flash, and it has a inside. For use cases where you need to add on expansion ports, there's a GPIO thing out here. You can open it. So, why? What do you do with this? So, we have seen quite a lot of use cases. Typical ones is, you know, like the hacker, maker, space person, other sensors, okay, that comes to I think it's a weather station, also put it into industry 4.0 use cases where you mount it up to production plants, production machines, and try to collect data and do things like predictive maintenance. Yeah. Here, that's a really small scale application.
If you want to get started.
One funny thing we did at the beginning of this year was to put this on the coffee machine. So we put two of these on the coffee machine, we collected data, applied FFT on it, and we were able to predict if you were asking for a cappuccino, or an espresso, or even if there's whether the milk level is down. Because the amount of vibration, the amount of data you get, which is 3,000 values per second, is good enough for you to get this kind of reading. So you can see there's a lot of data, you do FFT, you can actually figure out a lot of things with this.
So like that.
I wouldn't go into this, I'm not going to go into this much. But the interesting thing here is what it comes with is things like light sensor, everywhere, and Wi-Fi. All these are inbuilt as well. It's provided by you, you can source out. Since it's an EFM chip by Silicon Labs, the EM link is also included. Yeah, so you don't have to Google or library. How to develop it? So we provide a workbench interface. It's free for free on iOS, mentioned on Silicon Labs, or instances where you need to do debugging. You can, it supports the Sega debugger right here. But you can also just use it directly. If let's say you don't need debugging, you can just put a micro USB or rather micro USB cable and just flash it directly. Typically, if you're working with those kind of chip makers, you need specialized programmers, right? The way they did it is we just use a regular micro USB cable. You don't need special programmers for this. Yeah, so next, what I'm going to show you is a small demo. where I'm going to use Bluetooth LE and just show, you know, how the data comes in. Yeah, so you can see. Hello? Okay. Is it still working?
Hello?
You can see it's pretty high frequency. Yep. And at the same time, it's collecting all the data. You can see parametric pressure. Yes, thank you. Bluetooth, but we've implemented. We've implemented where we're doing telemetry over live with MQM, up to the RabbitMQ, down to web sockets, into the web. Yeah, because not always you can do we've also connected it via LoRa, you know, obviously, you know, this kind of. Yeah. And we'll talk about it later.